I'm Ben.
I'm Sori.
And this is the Animals, the Rising Sun. Or is the House of the Rising Sun? What is it?
I don't know. He told me that it was the Rising Sun.
The House of the Rising Sun.
No, I see. He said House of the Rising Sun. Yep.
I see here on the lyrics, it's House of the Rising Sun.
This is for Ultimate Musings, who is doing a shout out to big hot homie Tyrone.
Call Tyrone. Call him. You know what I'm talking about? Tell the truth. For timely topical political commentary, and if you want to know why Vincent is the most compelling yet frustrating individual on the internet, you can go to Middle America with Ben and Sori. A lot of frustrated, well, not a lot of frustrated people.
They're awesome!
Middle America with Ben and Sori, you can check it out. We're updating that pretty frequently because we've got a president that makes for very good news. There are multiple ways to get your song reviewed, dear listener. My favorite way is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon where you get recruited by the greats like Kellandra, Zonia, all that jazz, all those beautiful people. You get to meet them, you get to play Dungeons & Dragons, you get to commiserate. If you're mad at me particularly, then you go out there in one of your little groups and you can talk about it. All that good jazz. $1 at the gate gets you in at Patreon. If you don't want to go with the community option, you want to be a filthy capitalist like Sori, you can take the fast pass option, $125. No, Ultimate Musings is different.
Oh!
Don't mention Ultimate Musings in your stuff. Oh. He's one of my guys, huh? $125 gets you in straight to the head of the line. You don't have to wait for anybody, and you don't have to haggle with your teammates in an alliance, and that's how your song gets reviewed. You do that 3 times, you get shifted down to the $75 rate, and then on top of that, you get the VIP lifetime access to the restricted sites on the website, which are coming up pretty soon. Without further ado, this is House of the Rising Sun. The name of the band is The Animals.
Headphones on.
And it's been answer.
Sounds so.
It sounded absolutely familiar to me as well. Babe, your candy is all over the place and I'm sticking everywhere.
Good.
No.
So the House of the Rising Sun is a, was it a bar in New Orleans somewhere?
Well, yeah. I thought it was interesting that the house, I didn't think that was the name of the place. To me, it was just, you know, when someone gambles so long the sun comes up.
Yeah, but it's called the House of the Rising Sun.
Yes, but I don't think the name of the bar is the House of the Rising Sun.
There's a house in New Orleans called the House of the Rising Sun. They call the Rising Sun.
I think that people call it that, but I don't think that's the actual name of it. Listen, I can have my own opinion.
There's a house.
There's a house in New Orleans. They call the Rising Sun. I think that people have named it that. Because the gambling happens there, and they are there so long, the sun rises.
Where are you getting that?
The gambler? He's going back to gamble? What do you mean, where am I getting that?
Where does it say that they stay there all night and then
the
sun
comes
up?
No, I'm saying that's why I think they call it that, the House of the Rising Sun. Why do you think it's called the House of the Rising Sun? Does that sound like a typical gambling?
Because the first two lines says there's a house in New Orleans they call the Rising Sun.
Who's they?
The people who own the house.
Well, I don't believe it's the people that own the house. I think it's the people that go there. Yeah. I think they've named it.
I just can't deal with the postmodernism.
Oh my word.
Facts don't care about your feelings.
Ew.
Okay.
As long as it sounds believable, that's the point.
You shouldn't have said. I'm actually going to be very interested to see, because they never go after you, but you really do a lot of real dick moves a lot of the time. I'm usually pretty nice to these people, like when I get on here. So I'm going to wait. Hey, Kay, if you have any sort of semblance of manhood, you got to go after her for that shit. I didn't do it.
What?
I don't think it's going to happen.
No, everybody knows that was a silly line. Come on.
Hey, I'm not saying nothing about it. My mother was a tailor. She sewed my new blue jeans. My father was a gambling man down in New Orleans.
Yep.
Now, the only thing a gambler needs is a suitcase and a trunk. And the only time he'll be satisfied is when he's all drunk. It's really interesting. He talks about his mom, and his mom is, like, very productive. She's doing productive stuff. Not only, I mean,
well, she
was
works
a tailor.
As a tailor, but she's also making his clothes so they can make ends meet.
Right. And his dad is just, you know, I always wonder about the whole gambling thing. Like, we had a dude that was a had a gamble. I don't want to know if it was a gambling addiction. I never really jumped into this guy's life. So
that's
to that degree. So I never I wouldn't call it an addiction. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Well, I would. He would get up in the middle of the night, start gambling away, and he gambled away all of his tax return. His wife didn't know anything about it. That's a problem.
Oh. Was I there when he would talk about that?
I don't think so.
Yeah, that to me is a really...
It's so bizarre to me because I always feel like that if a guy gets up in the middle of the night to do something on the computer, it's going to be pornography. You were so basic. You're so nice to me, babe. Yeah,
I'm sure What's-His-Face is going to jump on that. It's going to overlook you. Yeah, wait, woman, I'm going to tell them an African-American. Yeah. The gambling thing is a real... I almost wonder what addiction is worse between, like, being a drunk and being a gambler. To you, it looks like you're saying that there's an obvious winner.
Well, no, I thought you were going somewhere else with it. No, between being a drunk and a gambler? No, because the drunk can still, you know, put all your money away.
You'd be a functional alcoholic.
Yeah, but you can also be extremely abusive as an alcoholic.
See,
I've heard a lot of stories of kids being harmed in lots of different ways by their fathers when they were drinking. Where, like, I don't see a gambler. Like, a gambler, I think he's going to be pissed when he loses all his money. But I don't think he's like, oh, let me go back and be a predator.
We saw one show where the guy had a gambling issue and it completely ruined him. And it ruined his family. Mm-hmm. And he put his family in peril. I just don't know. I think maybe because for the most part, a lot of gambling was illegal. I mean, they're opening it up now.
Yeah.
But back in the day, gambling was illegal. So you didn't really have a lot of, like, out there, like, support systems and things like that because they would just put you in jail. Yeah. Because they criminalized gambling. And so because of that, Mafia and all those guys were involved in it, just like they were involved during the Prohibition period. And then once you legalized alcohol, then, you know, they took a hit there. But a lot of the, you know, when I was going through my phase of listening to John Francis and all these Mafia dudes, they would talk about, like, they would make a chunk of their money through gambling, you know, and collecting those debts. So I'm not sure. I mean, we know about the alcoholic dad and things like that. And I think gambling is also one of those things that you can hide, whereas alcoholism you can't. I think you can hide gambling. I think you could say, I'm going, you know, to work for a week. And the guy blows all his money. And then you just come back and say, oh, we're just struggling, or... You know, the car broke down or whatever. So I'm not, but I don't know.
Plus, I don't know that you could run up a tab that big, like, at a bar. You know what I mean? Like,
that's the other thing, right? I don't think people go to bar. I mean, I don't know.
I'm sure that there are places where you can run up a tab, but I'm sure that the bar itself caps you at a certain amount where if you don't pay it, you're not going to keep getting free drinks.
Well,
when it's gambling, they kind of let people, from what I've seen, get out of control, go beyond their means.
Oh, and now you're putting your mortgage on the thing. Yeah, no, I. That's another good point, is that there's, you know, and a lot of times, even if you have the money, if the bar guy sees that you're too much, they won't even serve you anymore.
Yeah, I mean,
that's what we've seen in the movie. I'm sure that happens. So I'm not particularly. I don't know which one is worse, you know? The gambling thing is just very intriguing to me because it's such a... I could definitely see how somebody could get sucked into it. Because, like, oh, you're one number off, and, you know, maybe next time. And then over here you hear, oh, so-and-so won this thing. You're like, oh, I'm just wrong away. But then it's like, even when they win, I was watching this documentary, even when they win, they take their winnings and they gamble it again. Like,
right, because they think they're going to win bigger.
Yeah, and then they set up.
And then there's that mindset where it's like, well, somebody's going to win, so why wouldn't it be me this time?
Yeah, and then they set up the casino to where, like, you get lost. It's like they make it like a maze so that, like, you don't know where the exit is. So, like, you'll stay for an extra 5 minutes, which then converts to an extra 5 hours.
Yeah, I heard they don't put windows so you can't see that it's daylight, and that they pump. I don't know if that's true, but I heard they pump oxygen in there so you feel more awake.
Well, so. That was the thing. Like, there isn't an explicit biblical passage that says you shall not gamble. So that was the thing with this guy. Remember the guy that we were talking to, and he was like, oh, there's nothing in the Bible says that I can't gamble, da 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 da.
They used to say, when I was growing up, like, that was, like, a big thing at my uncle's church, like, gamblers, like, that was so bad. And I had a family member that would in my opinion, she was a recreational gambler with her husband. They would go together. But it, to me, it didn't seem like, you know, they lived in an apartment, and they never bought a house. But you know what? Some people don't want the hassle of the house and the maintenance and all that. So maybe they were doing what they wanted to do. You know what I mean?
But
everybody would, like, go after them about it. And the verse that they used was something. There's a verse about making quick money.
Really?
Now I have to know.
I don't think so.
In Proverbs.
Just put Proverbs.
I don't know if
quick money Bible verse. Proverbs 13:11, maybe?
The verse tells us, what is it? How do we see it? Right here?
Money that comes easily disappears quickly, but money that is gathered little by little will grow. That's not saying you shouldn't gamble.
I don't know if that was the exact verse.
Yeah,
I thought it used the phrase quick. Well, that one basically did, so.
Yeah, there's the argument, like, the stock market is like a gamble, but it's really not, like. When I hear Sonia talking about the stock market, like, it doesn't seem like she's gambling. It seems like she's applying her wisdom and things of that nature. So I just don't know. This is a very, very fascinating subject to me because we were in the middle of a lot of people with a lot of addictions and things like that, whether it's, you know, substance abuse or you know, endorphin, you know, pornography, whatever. But this one guy had a gambling issue, and there are just so many people and so many problems to deal with, and I was just like, you were engaging with the guy. I wasn't engaging with him at all because, you know, I was just overloaded with problems from people. But it's a really interesting conversation. Yeah, I think I said something like, no, there's no injunction against gambling, but, you know, you're supposed to be wise and provide for your family or something like that. Because there were issues financially with him.
Well, yeah. I mean,
then he went and told everybody I told him not to gamble, and was one of the million things he was mad about. He's like, I wasn't gambling anymore, blah, blah, blah. I was like, poor thing.
Weird.
So the only thing a gambler needs is a suitcase and a trunk, and the only time he'll be satisfied is when he's all drunk. I would assume that there's a lot of the correlation between alcohol and gambling, for sure. Yeah, I don't, that seems like a really scummy thing to do to have a casino, man. I don't know if, like, 80% of their revenue is coming off of people who, in a drunken stupor, or, you know, sell off their mortgage or whatever. I just think that's, I don't know. I feel like that's, like, you found a loophole and it's really horrible.
Yeah.
But what can you do? People with addictive personalities, you gotta learn how to manage that stuff, man. I don't know. Mother, tell your children not to do what I've done. Spend your lives in sin and misery in the house of the right. Okay, so it looks like he took after his dad and not after his mother.
Yeah.
Which is really an interesting setup, right? Like, the setup was, he's got his mom who's a productive person, who's got a job apparently, and she can do stuff for the family, and then you've got a dad who is unproductive and destructive.
It's the weirdest thing, but kids oftentimes follow the path of their father. It happens a lot. Like, there are, of the people that I can think of, almost all of them followed their fathers.
I don't know if I followed my father. Well, I don't know. I didn't live with my dad. But there's events in my life that replicate my dad. But I don't think that that's more God's providence than me actually living out my dad's life. So I don't know. Because I don't have a lot of examples. But you think people follow their dads? Dorian is not like me at all.
I'm just thinking about, like, one of the things that he said where, you know, like, he really looks up to you, but it's basically, like, more or less, there won't be that long before he's going to be better than you, so he won't need your take on things because he doesn't realize that the older that he gets, the older you get, so you're both gaining wisdom.
Yeah.
So, no, I think that in some instances, he doesn't know all about you, but I think that there are some instances where he's, you know, he's got some similarities with you.
Yeah, I don't know. On the major stuff, though, I don't. He's not on the major stuff. He's not gonna follow my footsteps. Like I don't think like he's not that type of guy.
Yeah, but at the same time, that's not how you raised your kids. You didn't raise your kids to follow you. You raised them to think and to make decisions and choices. And
that's true. They were not socialized to just listen to me.
Right.
And whatever. Yeah, that's true. But it's interesting. I don't know that people follow their dad or their mom. I mean, I feel like I'm way more like following in my mom's footsteps than I did my dad.
Yeah, your mom, I feel like, is a special case where her personality is extremely strong, and I think you guys were already very similar, you and your mom.
Tupac followed his mother. Not really his dad, but he didn't know his dad. I don't know. So you think that if his dad was a tailor and sewed him jeans and his mother was a drunk and a whatever, that he would have been a tailor?
I think that he would have had a better chance. Because I think that just now, like without saying, okay, the father is the leader of the house, I think that male influence naturally has that.
On sons or just the kids in general?
Good question.
I got one foot on the platform, the other foot on the train.
Going back to New Orleans to wear that ball and chain. Like, he knows how bad it is. He's going right back to where his father was.
Yeah, I actually took that as a metaphor for his life, as far as life and death goes. Because the train is taking him somewhere. He's got one foot on the platform. So he's, like, between life and death. And he's basically going over there to die.
My nana used to say, I got one foot in the rock pile and the other foot on a banana peel. Jesus, that's me.
Okay.
She would always say things like that.
Well, what's interesting is he addresses the mother. Mother, tell your children not to do what I've done. Spend your lives in sin and misery in the house of the rising sun. So his mother, the female characters are always the good characters, the solid, the moral characters who pass on stuff. And he and his dad, they're, you know, he's basically saying that me and my dad have now become precautionary tales. They're not, you know, it's just very interesting. You know, I shot a Father's Day video for my dad. And my dad was in a pretty unique situation. Like I didn't go and say like explicitly what happened, but my older brother and I were essentially kidnapped by my mother, and so I didn't grow up with my dad, but it was definitely not his choice. I mean, I didn't say it in that particular forum because, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. But I didn't come out and say it, but I don't know, I just felt like I needed I don't know if it's clear the air, because people knew that I didn't grow up with my dad, and like one of my songs had the line, I never bothered with a father and we made it fine. I wouldn't necessarily change. I wouldn't change that line, but I just felt like I was like I needed to like clear the air, maybe defend my dad. Like I said, I never grew up with him, and like to this moment, you know, the relationship is like weird. Like even when I think about talking to him, because I have his number, like calling him or something like that, it just makes me so tired and exhausted, you know, mentally. So it's a weird, so like looking at this song, like hearing what you're saying, all that stuff, it's like, I don't know, like the relationship sons have with their dads is a very interesting relationship, but you know, he followed in his father's footsteps and he's basically got nothing good to say about his father, and it's all like toward his mother.
Yeah.
And you know, Solomon, like he's traditionally credited with writing much of the book of Proverbs, and the Proverbs starts off with, you know, listen to the wisdom of your father and your mother, but then at the end of Proverbs it's specifically his mother giving him the wisdom. And when I think about the whole dynamic between Solomon, David, and Solomon's mom, I think Solomon probably had a hard time respecting the wisdom of his father, just because of the way his father handled. His father was David, you know, David and Goliath did. He handled certain things in a way that was not wise, in my opinion. Like the whole situation with his daughter. And his,
yeah. Yeah.
So he just, but it seems like he garnered a lot of wisdom from his mother and had a very, very, very high regard for his mother. So much so that the majority of the book is contrasting Lady Wisdom with, you know, Lady Folly or whatever. Mm-hmm. So wisdom is personified as a woman in Proverbs, and that's, that to me is like the ultimate testament of his relationship with his mother, and not his, and almost to the exclusion of his dad. I mean, he says something about his dad at the beginning, but most of Proverbs is feminine.
Yeah, I think, though, there's what you just said, but I think there's also the practical. So, like, yeah, we both run the YouTube channel, but you're the one that does the side work. You do a lot of messaging back people in the, you know, the comment sections and email and all that stuff. So you're a lot more busy than I am. And, like, as far as who gets more sit-down time with the kids or more time for passing on of wisdom, I get a lot more time like that with them. So you... Right. You'll sit down and do like a 2-hour, 4-hour chunk with them, but mine is spaced out through every single day. I spend some time with them, talking to them and stuff like that. So I think that just in a practical sense, that's going to happen with a mother. If you're looking at a household where the mom is the one that's caring for the kids and the father's the one that's working the job, then that would kind of just happen, you know, naturally.
Well, it was weird because in my previous relationship, I was all of that.
Yeah, I know.
They would never...
Yeah.
You know, and yes. I was out of the house a lot more for work, and I was out of the country for work. So I hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
But there's just a lot of like untied shoestrings for me. But I like the organ. I actually like the song. It was kind of like a short and sweet, but I swear to God, I've heard that lick before. I've heard it before, and I've heard that vocal style before.
Yeah.
And I don't know if maybe this is like a staple. I want to really, really check out the comment section. I don't know if it's like in the soundtracks of a certain, like...
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know.
It's very familiar to me as well.
It's something very familiar. What a good song.
Oh, gosh. I mean, it wasn't like... all like upbeat and killing you know what I mean, like it, but it had like a sort of, geez, I don't really know, I guess
1964 live.
Yeah, I saw this on the side. It said although the date and the author of the song are unknown, so they don't even know where the song originally came from.
50, the song's almost 60 years old. That's insane. That's insane.
Yeah, probably like an 8.9. I mean 8.7.
There's something about this song that bothers me a lot.
I was gonna say, I forgot to say that, actually. It was a song, it depressed me. Made me feel depressed partway through all of a sudden.
I don't know if I'm just bothered by it. And I'm not particularly sure why I'm bothered by it. So because of that, it's gonna get a 9.6. Because I haven't been this bothered by a song in a very long time. I don't know. Maybe it's his relationship with his dad, maybe it's his relationship with his mom, I'm not sure. But good. I like songs that bother me. So I'm gonna give this a 9.6 for the botheration. Shout out to
Tyrone.
To shout out to Mark. Shout out to Kellen Jaws. You better go after her, Kel. I'm taking a card. Been out.
Thorio.
Gone. He ain't got that. He ain't got that.
Tell your children.